All right, ladies and gentlemen. So I am not going to be here. Little Hanky Bo Banky is not feeling well. So with that being said, tomorrow I'm not here. There is no vocab quiz for 21 through 30. We did the grand scores today. With that being said, I am recording two lectures today. This is part one. Tomorrow you will have part two, which will also be posted today. Is everyone clear? Okay, so the test will still be on Thursday. Just because I'm not here, it does not mean. So in class tomorrow, you can either watch the lecture I posted or you could work on your focus, whichever way you can use your time wisely. Sitting here doing nothing is a waste of your time and my time, yes? Okay, so tomorrow I will not be here. Today I'll be posting two lectures. They'll be very clearly labeled. This is first period. You are getting part one. So tomorrow you should be watching part
two.
There you go. On the top of your notes, you should have week five. Oh, it's better if you can see, don't you think? Perfect. Here we go. Transaharan trade. Now, every time we cover Transaharan trade, we add more layers to it. As time evolves, that's the difference. Okay, so Transaharan trade is where we are. You need to know that missionaries by Muslims, merchants are going to increase trade. Why? How does having people convert to Islam increase trade? AC. There you go. So what famous civilization converts to Islam to attract more people, Riley? Malai. Now, when we talk about merchants, this unit is really about cultural development and connectivity. When we're talking about these Muslim merchants, they're not just bringing religion, and you should write this down. They are bringing architecture, Islam, and trade. Okay? So it's not just religion and being saved by Allah. It is also architecture, desire for trade, and the actual faith itself, so please keep that in mind. Under Islam, women get more freedom. Okay, women are more free in Islam than in any other religion. In the continent of Africa, women have more freedom pre-European arrival. So we are pre-European arrival. So the best place to be a woman is in an Islamic part of. There you go. That is the best place to be. Now, as soon as the Europeans show up, they start pulling the men, things get really bad for the women. Okay? So, pre-European arrival, the best place in the world to be a woman is an Islamic part of Africa. Make sure you know that. Now, when we are talking about trade, one of the biggest things is the Somali camel saddle. It is located, it is from East Africa because that's where Somali is. The Horn of Africa is where the Somali peninsula is. Now, the reason why it's a big deal, it will dramatically increase the cargo a camel can carry. Why is it important if a camel can carry more stuff? Think about it logically. It's as simple as you think, but why, Charlie? Yes! So, Charlie, if you're going to make a 200-mile journey and you can carry 100 pounds worth of stuff, or 600 pounds worth of stuff, which makes it more worth your time. There you go, because you can sell 500 more pounds of stuff, which will make it much more worthwhile. Now, when we are talking about innovations, we got the Somali camel saddle as well as caravans. The idea of groups of people traveling together may not sound like an innovation, like, oh, duh, it makes perfect sense you would do that. It is an innovation, though. And that's something you really need to kind of wrap your head around. Just like champa rice, moving it from one region to the next doesn't sound like an innovation, but it is an innovation because someone had to sit there and be like, ah, let's do that. So it is going to make trade safer, which means more people are going to trade, which means more trade is happening. Okay, so your major people, Iban Batua, ladies and gentlemen, he is going to keep coming up and up and up again. So just commit him to memory. that the majority or minority? Majority. You need to know that he is going to be in the Indian Ocean Basin, Trans-Saharan, a little bit of Europe. Where do you think he's going to be?
Spain.
Okay. He's going to be a little bit in Europe, Indian Ocean Basin, Trans-Saharan trade, and he's going to be, of course, in the Middle East. Okay, so those are the major areas. Now, the thing he writes about much, the most, are cultural traditions. He finds culture to be fascinating. Cultural traditions are what he really spends most of his time doing. Then it's gonna be political and societal traditions. Okay, so he really enjoys the political stuff, but then political and societal. It is important that you write down, put a star. It's not just the wealthy and powerful that he documents. It is not just the wealthy and powerful. He documents about the everyday interactions he has with everyday people, and that's a huge component. Now, you know Marco Polo's name because of that stupid pool game. Ivan Batua is more important to us than Marco Polo. Okay? Now, Ivan Batua is more important than Marco Polo. He's more reliable because he writes a journal versus a book, which we talked about in our do note today. Now, Marco Polo. By the way, look at how intense this picture is of Ivan Batua. Piercing, right? Oof. Anyway, here we go. You don't think that's a piercing look? That's like intense. No? All right. Marco Polo. Marco Polo is also wandering around this time. He's from the Mediterranean Basin, aka Italy. He goes through the Middle East and goes all the way to China. You need to know, he is in Yan, China. Oh my God, who's in charge if the Yan dynasty is in power, Maya? Kublai Khan or the Mongols, okay? Kublai Khan is in power. When Marco Polo gets there, I would make a note of that. He is in China during the Yan Dynasty, which means the Mongols are in power. Kublai Khan is in power in China while he's there. These are how this interconnectedness you do need to know. Now, you need to know he's looking for trade opportunities. He's tired of paying Muslims for goods from China. He wants to make money. So he is trying to learn how to trade. The problem is he gets distracted by all the other stuff and doesn't really learn how to trade. And he decides to have more life experiences than, you know, work experiences, and, you know, gets arrested. So what he does is when he goes back to Europe, he brings his book with him, publishes his book, okay? Now, and this is the big thing about Marco Polo, and you're going to put a star. He inspires Europeans to go to China. That's really what he does. He creates these really fabulous stories of wealth and goods and culture that people are like, oh my God, I gotta see it. So, Ivan Batua gives us historians plenty of insight into the actual culture and development of four major regions. Marco Polo creates a sensationalized book about China, and it inspires white people to go to China. Now, long term, how is this going to work out for China with a bunch of white people coming? Not so well for it. But here we are. So, the other thing you need to know is it is going to show Europeans how behind they are. Okay? It is going to be the first time that Europeans really hear how behind they are in comparison to another region. And that's why so many people want to go to China to kind of see it. Like, for instance, most of you probably want to go see Dubai, right? Because that's like the city of the future. Yes? Okay? They're doing tons of really cool, crazy stuff. That is very inspiring. We want to see what the future looks like.
that's what kind of Marco Polo did for China. Like, this is the future. This is what they're doing. It's really cool. So, okay.
All right. Now, couple big things. Malai is still happening. So, with Malai, Timbuktu becomes a major cultural center. Okay, so Malai is still happening. Okay, you need to know it becomes one of the richest civilizations in the world. Because of its gold, ladies and gentlemen. Now, Malai is going to rise in power because of its gold. It is going to make Timbuktu a cultural center, and it is going to create a growth of government. Why does the government grow with an increase of gold? Come on now, pull it through. Danny.
Because people are trading, so they need to, like, control the trade that's happening.
Yeah, it becomes more centralized. The more trade increases, the more centralized the government. Why is that unique in Africa? Cole, why is that unique in Africa?
It's unique in Africa because there are not many centralized governments.
Absolutely. And why are there many centralized governments in Africa, Cole?
Because there's, like, not a lot of agricultural land, so there's less food, so less.
Cole is ready for this. Hell yeah, Cole. There's not that much agricultural land in Africa. The only reason we have a kingdom of Malai is because of the trade, which is bringing in food, bringing in wealth. That is why we have a highly centralized government. Now, what we are going to see is you are going to start seeing people are going to be attracted to Africa because of the natural resources. Okay, the wealth of Africa is going to start spreading to other territories. Is this a good thing or a bad thing for Africa long term?
Bad thing.
People are going to start trying to take over territories in order to claim the resources. Okay. Your next heading is cultural and environmental consequences. So, this is cultural and environmental. Okay. So, spreading of technology is going to occur because of connectivity, which is a good thing. The two biggest items that are spreading during this time are champa rice and paper. Gunpowder and paper. Where are those coming from? Sevi, China. China's the original location. You need to know where the origin, and it's going to push westward. Towards Europe. That's where these resources and new innovations are going. You need to know where they're starting and where they're going. Who are the major purveyors of pushing gunpowder and paper westward? Who is it, AC? The Mongols. Ladies and gentlemen, this is our first little, like, kind of review. Every time we have a writing week, which is Friday, it's usually the week before is like a review and kind of pulls certain trends through. So we're kind of in a review. You already know about Malai. You already know about gunpowder. You already know about paper. This unit is kind of a review of the big themes and really pushing certain narratives. Okay? So you need to know champa rice is moving from India to China. Now, China already has it from Vietnam, but it is moving into the western parts. Okay, now a couple other big things. The seafaring is made easier. Okay, so maritime trade is getting easier. What are some of the big innovations that are coming out to make seafaring or maritime trade easier? What do we got, Riley? Latin sails, astrolabe, jukes. Are all the technology, do we remember this from last week? Those types of things are happening. Now, what we are going to see, ladies and gentlemen, because of these new technology, we're gonna see a growth in cities. Now, cities are going to grow for multiple reasons. However, the biggest thing is going to be political stability, and put a big star next to it. Political stability is the number one reason why cities are growing. After the Mongols come in and pretty much take over everything, there's not a lot of conflict, right? What do we call the time period after the Mongols conquer and there's no more war, really? What do we call that, Alex?
Pax
Mongolia. Pax Mongolia. Because of that, we're going to have government stability. Okay, so the Mongols are in power for almost a third of the world. All around the world, because trade is booming because of increased goods on the Silk Road, increased technology on the Indian Ocean Basin, people are making lots and lots of money. If we have lots of money in our pocket, are we happy with the government or mad at the government? Happy. Think about today in 2022. With the U.S. economy, with inflation still being high and gas prices have declined a little bit, but they're still pretty high, are the people of the United States thrilled with Biden? No. He's in the 40s now. He was in the 30s, so he's doing better. But people aren't really that happy. If the economy tanks again under Biden, okay, how will the United States people feel? Yeah, I mean, right now it doesn't look like he's probably going to get reelected. Because at the 40%, it's not a great look, okay? So, with that being said, when the economy's not doing well, people aren't happy with the government. When people have lots of money in their pocket, people love the government. Do we see how this is working? Trade around the world has increased during this time period, so people all around the world are happy. They're happy. Now, what we are going to see, political stability is going to lead to more trade. More trade is going to lead to more trade is going to lead to more connectivity, which means new inventions are moving through. So, new religions, ladies and gentlemen, is your next subheading. Okay, you need to know Buddhism. And honestly, I think this is like the hardest part of this unit is knowing where the religions are going. Okay, so this is where I think is honestly the hardest part. Here we go. Religions. First one is Buddhism. Buddhism originally comes from where? I've taught you this. Where does it originally come from, Kent? India or South Asia. It's now in China, Korea, and Vietnam. Why is it in China? Who can pull it through? Maya.
Because when the Mongols were in power, they had like religious tolerance, and so Taoism
was a huge influence. So proud, Maya. Yes, because they're no longer forcing the Confucian narrative. So it gives other religions the ability to thrive. It goes to Korea because Korea is heavily influenced by China, and it goes to Vietnam because of the same things, okay? So, Buddhism is now heavily embedded in China, Korea, and Vietnam because Confucianism is no longer being pushed by the government. Now, the reason why Buddhism is popular, it's popular with the lower class. Popular with the lower class, you need to know that, because it's a rejection of wealth, it's a rejection of societal ideas. It's an escape from the structures of society. So, it's popular with the lower classes, it's being spread to China, Korea, and Vietnam. It's a rejection of societal norms. Now, Buddhism and Hinduism are spreading to Southeast Asia. What is the major country in Southeast Asia, Drew?
Thailand.
So keep that in mind. Southeast Asia is the only place what religion goes to? Hinduism. Why is Hinduism not very popular outside South Asia, Ava? The caste system. It's very oppressive. And if you're new to Hinduism, do you go to the top or the bottom? Bottom. And no one wants to be like low man on the totem pole, so people don't really convert to it. With that being said, You need to know the Khmer Empire is going to be using Hinduism and Buddhism. They use both. Both Hinduism and Buddhism come from what region? South Asia. So why would a country in Southeast Asia pick up these religion, Riley? Yes, yes. They are the heaviest trading partners of South Asia, and that's why its influence is really high. All right. Okay. Islam is the most popular religion, and it's going everywhere. Except what region is not getting Islam? What region in the whole world is not getting Islam? What? Adriana? Europe, technically the Spanish are Muslims. Olivia? The Americas, because no one's gone over there yet because we're in the 1200s, 1300s at this point. And when does Christopher Columbus sail the ocean blue? 1492. So keep that in mind. We're just shy of it. Okay. You need to know Africa becomes the center of Islam. What major city becomes the center of African Islamic scholarship, Owen? Timbuktu. Okay. So Africa becomes the center of Islam. Timbuktu becomes the center of Islamic scholarship. Okay. Now, you need to know that in South Asia, lower Hindus and Buddhists are going to convert to Islam. Okay? Buddhism is really tricky. Buddhism is really tricky. To be a Buddhist, you kind of forfeit the ideas of normal of society, like wealth and possessions and stuff like that. Do you think a lot of people really buy into it in a big way? How many Buddhists do you know? None. I think I know like one or two. And I don't know how good they are being Buddhists. Does that make sense? Okay. Because Buddhist is like a rejection of societal norms, like wealth, privilege, and all that stuff. And what do most people live for? Wealth, privilege, stuff, those types of things. So disillusioned Buddhists are going to convert to Islam because you have that deep connection with God and you can still have worldly possessions, which people like being comfortable. Okay. The Bhakti movement, okay, is going to find connections between Hinduism and Islam. Where are we seeing the Bhakti movement? Oh my God, guys, what place has Hinduism and Islam? South Asia. You need to know the Bhakti movement is going to be happening in South Asia because they're trying to forge a relationship between Hindus and Muslims. And South Asia, is there a beautifully warm relationship between Muslims and Hindus? Hell no! They're still killing each other today in 2022. So imagine how bad the blood is back then. Okay, so the Bhakti movement is going to try to start finding a connection between these two religions to find some peace between them. Okay. Because of the spread of Islam, we start seeing Islamic architecture all around the world. So, the most common type of architecture will be Islamic for this time period. Okay. During this time period, Islamic architecture is going to be the biggest one. And every time a Muslim shows up someplace, they increase that region's trade. And that's a huge thing. Yeah, the Muslims are always bringing trade, and that is going to be a major focus. Nice. Okay. Questions about religion? That's a lot of stuff, and it's kind of icky. You doing okay? I will say, I wish you had boards tonight. I'm just going to say. My next class, I'm going to make them take up boards. Because you're not going to have boards tomorrow, obviously, because I'm not here. Okay, here we go. Your next one is Black Plague. Your environmental, it's going to be Black Plague. Okay, first and foremost, you need to know it is going to kill 1/3 of the world's population. You need to know who is really gonna spread it and facilitate it. Cool. The Mongols are the ones who are really going to spread it and facilitate it. Now, the Black Plague, you need to know, starts in China and will spread all the way to Europe. What will carry it there? Trade. Specifically, what trade route? Silk Road. Okay, now, what you need to know is that labor systems will be dramatically affected. Why will labor systems be dramatically affected, Caesar? What is it? Yeah, it spreads between them. So what happens to all the labor, Caesar? Yeah, they all die. Yeah. Guys, even in our pandemic in 2020, the labor systems are what is having the biggest change post then, yes? How many people do you know work from home every day? That's a huge difference than it was before 2020. How many of you know someone who changed their job since 2020? How many of you know someone who's changed jobs maybe even twice since 2020? The labor market is totally different now because when a pandemic comes through, it changes the way we see things, and the easiest thing to change is our labor. Okay, now, back then, of course, all these people are dying. Our pandemic, thank God, we all didn't die, because that would have sucked. However, all right, so, ladies and gentlemen, you need to know that it is going to hurt Europe very badly. It hurts Europe very badly because Europe was just getting on their feet when the pandemic breaks out. So the progress they were making slips back down. Okay, big star, feudalism collapses because of it. Why does feudalism collapse because of it? We've talked about it. Why? Kent? Yeah, absolutely. Feudalism is based on rights and obligations. You had the right to protection, the obligation of farming. Well, can a knight protect you from a pandemic? No, absolutely not. So they're all dying and they're like, hell no, I'm not doing this for free. Okay. Now, it is important to know that Europe is going to be hit the hardest. However, it is also going to recover better than any other territory. It's hit the hardest, but it will recover better than any other territory, and that's a unique component of it. Because after the pandemic comes through, who begins rising in power and eventually will take over the world? Europeans. Okay? So. Cool? So. Migration of crops is your next heading. Any questions about Black Plague? We're okay? Perfect. Okay, migration of crops. Champa rice. We love champa rice, yes? Okay, why is champa rice so important? What is it and what makes it special, Ethan? There you go. Population is going to boom because there's two crops a year or two harvests a year. People are going to be having more food, which means less people need to be farmed, so we have proto-industrialization is going to be sparked in China because of it. Champa rice is going to increase food production in China, Korea, and India. India, it gets it. India, China, Korea, and Vietnam. It starts in Vietnam, keep that in mind. So those territories are now having booms. Your next major crop are bananas, and they are coming from Southeast Asia, and they are going to Africa, and they're going to create a huge population boom. Why? Why are they going to cause a huge population boom, Flynn? Sure, but why is that a big deal in Africa? There's no maize in Africa right now. There's no interconnectedness. Corn doesn't really exist anywhere else outside of America at this point. Now, can you imagine a life without, like, tortillas? They didn't have flour tortillas because they didn't know really about them. They used to make like bread and stuff, but like tortillas and tacos, that's an American thing. Yeah. They used to have like kind of versions of it a little bit different, but that doesn't really spread around the world. But yeah, corn is really only in the Americas with the Colombian exchange. Is that a life you want to lead? It's Tuesday, friends. It's Taco Tuesday. Imagine a life without Taco Tuesday. But keep in mind, because the Colombian exchange isn't open yet and you don't even know what this term is, that your tacos would not have chicken or beef on them yet. Because in the Americas, there's no chicken or beef.
What they eat then?
They don't have that much food.
Like, for me.
Guinea pigs? Yeah, guinea pigs are one of the biggest feeders. They used a lot of fish and stuff like that. But there's no big, like, animals of, like, remember they have unstable food systems in the Americas. Okay. Cotton, sugar, citrus fruits. Cotton, sugar, citrus fruits are going to be spreading from the Middle East through the Mediterranean basin. Okay, so. Now, environmental concerns is your next heading. Okay, larger populations. Around the world, there's larger populations because of tamper rice, bananas, and other access to food. The only place that's not getting population booms is the Americas. Keep that in mind because there's no connection yet. So, with that being said, because there's larger populations, they're putting more pressure on food sources. Now, having larger populations is going to cause overgrazing, deforestation, and soil erosion. Overgrazing is what, Giorgio? No, it has nothing to do with soil. What about it? What's overgrazing? Aiden.
The animals mow the grass and enjoy grass.
There you go. So there's no more food for the animals and the animals die, which means the humans can't eat. When we're talking about overgrazing, it's because they're putting too many animals on a certain amount of grass because the population has gotten so big. Okay? Now, if there's not enough food for the animals die, which means there's no long-term food solutions for the humans. So both the animals and the humans are starving, okay? So that's the problem with overgrazing. Now, when we talk about deforestation, that's when we're cutting down trees, yes? Okay? There are two problems with deforestation. The first problem is that we are creating soil erosion. What is soil erosion, Flynn? What happens to it if it's loose? You're completely right. What happens to it? What? Like it just gets up and starts dancing to the music or what?
It hits like one way by wind and like landslide.
It's usually water. The water will wash it away. Okay, so when we talk about deforestation, soil erosion is the biggest problem, which means all of the good nutrient-rich soil is now being washed away into rivers and streams and stuff like that, which is not good. The second major issue with deforestation is we now are losing animals because animals live in trees, which make forests and stuff like that, and they're looking for those types of protection from the forest. By cutting down the forest, these animals are going to lose their habitats, which means they have to move on, and that is not good for the animals. And if all the animals are gone, what are the humans eating? Nothing. So it causes a really vicious cycle and causes a lot of problems. Perfect. Oh my God, how exciting. So when we are talking about cultural and connectivity, ladies and gentlemen, we are really focusing on how does one civilization affect the next. We have a writing week starting on Friday, right, Jimmy? Which means we're kind of in a review-ish, which is why some of this content seems very like we've covered before, because we have covered it before. It's to kind of pull the themes through. Okay? So, I am not going to be here. I officially have a sum, so I will not be here tomorrow. I'm taking a day. I will be posting a second lecture here for you to help you review. Questions, concerns, comments. Do you have a quiz tomorrow? No, there is no quiz. However, you do need to submit your map and your primary, and you should be working on your focus. Is everyone clear on that? I will not be here tomorrow, but I will be here Thursday. Your test is on Thursday. Nothing changes our schedule. On Friday, I am here for you, but then I'm leaving because I'm going to the beach. And we need to write essays. Isn't that exciting? Yeah, it's going to be so much fun. So nice when we get all the way through.